HarperCollins presents How to Stop the End of the World by Tom Mitchell. Read by Jot Davies. Chapter 1. For Col Coleridge, the annual Westrum and Sevenoaks Family Athletics Day was like a visit to the dentist. Not only did it happen too regularly, but it was also, well, like the worst thing ever. Okay, so not the best comparison, but figurative language is difficult when you're blinded by passion, and Col really hated both orthodontics and field events, with a strength equalled only by his feelings towards screen time limits. It's not like his mum and dad ever set themselves screen time limits. And I have to say, I completely agree about the running. Screen time is a worry. Because how can running be fun? You don't see any animals doing it for the lols. Antelopes don't start giggling when they're being chased down by lions. Consider this. Have you ever seen a jogger smile? No. Case closed. I've never trusted anyone who claims to like running. But, unlike me, Col's parents couldn't understand his attitude. It was as if they spoke a different language to their son, ran on an alternative operating system. The headline event of the Westrum and Sevenoaks Family Athletics Day was the family relay race. Each family member held a baton and ran a certain number of metres that Col could never exactly remember, but was loads, literally hundreds, and then handed the baton to the next family member. Showing a complete lack of imagination, the winners were the first to cross the finish line. That was another thing Col didn't like about sports. They were always so predictable. Not like games. At least his Xbox had the power to surprise. Relay teams were meant to comprise four runners. But, as Mum had complained that this was prejudiced against one-child or single-parent families, Dad was allowed to run twice, at the start and at the end. Col was therefore third. That fateful day, he wore his special sports watch. A birthday present, it was a strangely pale blue, like it was ill. He hadn't asked for it, but had still tried to appear grateful because he was a good boy. In addition to showing the time, a genuinely useful feature, the watch could take all kinds of health readings when you're out being healthy. Col tended not to wear it, though, because the constant alerts that it was time to stand up got a bit annoying. And so he stood behind a line in his lane, the running track being a wonky set of squished and massive circles painted onto a local field more accustomed to dog poo and teenagers on quad bikes. Behind them were farmers' fields, and beyond these, Tower Wood. Col picked out his dad, lined up across the other side of the looping track. He was the only competitor to have adopted a runner's crouch rather than standing normally, because, you know, this wasn't the Olympics. There was no starter's pistol, something else that Col's mum had complained about, just a woman whom Col had seen earlier wearing a t-shirt with the slogan, "If I collapse, please pause my watch," with a really loud voice who shouted, "On your marks! Get set! Go!" Barely a second had passed before Dad was well ahead of the pack. By the time he'd reached Mum, who, with her specialist knowledge of baton-passing technique, had already started a slow jog, he was about a bus distance away from his closest rival, a girl Col's age. Baton successfully passed, Mum speeded up, her legs a blur of motion. It was now that Col's body began to move. Not his legs in a slow jog, as he'd been repeatedly instructed to do by both parents throughout the past week, but instead his stomach in an urgent cramp. It felt like it had shrunk to the size of an apple and was desperately trying to swap places with his heart. But his heart was having none of it and displayed its own displeasure by beating 10 times its normal speed. His watch vibrated an alert, but he dared not look in case it suggested he call an ambulance. Mum had turned the bend and was rushing down the straight like a lycra flood towards Col. Now really was the time to start moving. The kindly parent in the lane to his left, up ahead, said as much.
"I know," said Col.
At least that's what he'd intended to say. What emerged was more like,
"Gagalagawa."
"Go!" shouted Mum, now but a car's length away from Col, her arms furious pistons, the baton cutting through the air in brutal stabs. Her face was tight and strawberry red, and in no mood to be dealing with Colin being Colin. And Col did want to go. And Col did want to win the race. And if he'd taken the baton and walked to where his dad waited, the family would surely have done so.
"Col!"
shouted his father from his position round the track, the word sounding like a baby's scream. A really angry baby. Mum was so close that Col could smell her breath. He wanted to move. The only problem was that his legs didn't. They could have been made of wet sand for all the use they were to him. Mum could have continued running. She could have dodged round her son, missed him out of the relay altogether, and handed the baton directly to Dad. She didn't, though. Had she thought Col might break into a sprint at the last minute? Mothers are forever optimistic. They have to be. Alternatively, she could have stopped. She could have asked Col if he was okay and why he was gurning in that ridiculous way. But whatever she was thinking, she didn't stop. Not until she'd collided with Col, knocking him to the grass with an oof and landing on top of him in a barrage of sweat and sportswear.
"Ow!"
said Col.
"My bits!"
"First aiders to lane one!"
shouted the woman with a loud voice from the other side of the track. Col's mum was sharp and bony, all elbows and knees digging into the soft parts of her son's body. But this wasn't the greatest pain. The greatest pain, burning like a star in the centre of Col's skull, was the knowledge of what would surely follow. A telling off. Chapter 2.
"Were you trying to be funny? Was that it? You know, Col, there's enough going on in the world at the moment without having to worry about you."
"She's talking about climate change," said Dad.
Mum nodded.
"And double-digit inflation."
Mum nodded again.
"And global inequality."
Once more, Mum nodded.
"And the riots in..."
"Phil!" said Mum. "We get it. The point is, we can do without Col acting up."
Her voice changed, from strained to pleading.
"You know how much we love the annual Westrum and Sevenoaks Family Athletics Day, Colin."
She limped. She was definitely doing it for effect, and Col was trying his best not to feel guilty. Fine. She'd sworn when Dad had pulled her off Col, something he couldn't remember having heard before. But it hadn't really been that violent a collision. She'd turned her ankle, she'd claimed. People, we've all turned our ankles. I did so only last week, during a regrettable incident outside a sushi restaurant.
"And so not only do I have the indignity of today's incident," continued Col's mum, "but I'll also be off running for weeks."
Col could tell things were serious, because Mum didn't normally speak like this. Her words hot and indignant. In contrast, Dad had seemed muted, like someone had turned down his personality's volume. And as his mother limped, Col walked, and Dad talked.
"Did you see how far ahead we were?"
he said with a sigh.
"You could have walked it, son. You could have walked it."
"It's so important to be active," said Mum. "You don't understand now, but you'll be thanking us when you're our age. We are doing this for you. I'd take 1,000 ligament strains if only you would understand."
Cole felt like saying that the amount of pain she was in, exaggerated or not, suggested that being active was not only overrated but also dangerous. He didn't, though. Conversations like these came round about once a month, which corresponded pretty much to the regularity of his sporting disappointments. If he played the conversation well enough, it'd be over by the time they reached home, and depending on how satisfied his parents were with his assurances, he might even be able to get on his Xbox before dinner. His parents were annoying, but they weren't monsters.
Fit body, fit brain, said Dad.
It's healthy body, healthy brain, snapped Mum, grimacing.
Same difference, said Dad. And anyway, Cole, we're not expecting you to run for Kent or anything like that. We only want you to take an interest. It's like school. Nobody wants to go to school, but once you're there, it's fun.
I don't mind school, said Cole,
thinking this was a decent opinion to offer. And he wasn't even lying. At school, there were loads of adults, and only one ever got on his case about being active, and that was his PE teacher, which was fair enough, because it was literally his job.
We know you don't, son, said Mum,
her tone changing to a weird, almost pitying one. And we've warned you before about your Xbox, added Dad. You spend too long on it.
It keeps my fingers active, said Cole, and develops my hand-eye coordination.
I'll give you hand-eye coordination, said Dad,
intending it to sound like a threat, even though it made no sense. As Mum launched into the familiar speech about how she'd once received a promotion at work because her boss had seen her running and had been impressed by her tenacity, whatever that meant, Cole noticed something. There were strange markings on the pavement. At first, Cole assumed there were some bored kids' attempt at tagging. Westerham was close enough to London for locals to act like they lived in the big city, but distant enough for their efforts to be incredibly lame. Take, for instance, the gang that hung out on the playing fields at night. They wore hoodies and smoked vapes, but Cole knew for a fact that they all attended the local independent school. One of them was even called Algernon, which was a name that Cole would swap for his in an instant, but didn't suggest the mean and edgy street life of South London. But this wasn't the work of kids. There was something about the marks that was too arty, too mysterious. Tags were normally a recognisable word or a name. Eggs, for instance, or ads, or something like that. No, these weren't tags. They were something, but just what exactly wasn't clear. Like grainy footage of UFOs, if that makes sense. It's difficult to describe. The shapes had been drawn on the pavement in thick chalk, mostly white, but also blue and red. Were the different colours significant? The United Kingdom? Cole hoped it wasn't to do with politics. There'd been too much of that recently. There'd be groups of the markings in a row, then suddenly none, then maybe one or two, and then another cluster. It was difficult to see how the pattern made sense. Some of the symbols had faded with time, others looked fresh.
So, do you have anything to say for yourself? Asked Mum, before we get back home.
I had a panic attack, said Cole quickly. It happened to Jake in school, and his hands just froze, and he couldn't eat his sandwich because it was tuna.
What? Said Mum.
He's terrified of fish. Something traumatic happened at a sea life birthday party.
Cole paused for a second before attempting to change the conversation.
You know, in Brighton. Anyway, what do you think all these markings on the pavement mean?
Listen to your mother, said Dad. Pay attention. Because, in another reality, we three are walking home with gold medals round our necks. And I'm treating you to a Nando's, because Nando's are for winners. Do you know how long I've been looking forward to the relay?
It was something to do as a family.
The one time they'd been to Nando's, Dad and Mum had both asked for extra mild spiciness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.